Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Erev Tov, Le Kulam, Po Ba Berlin, Ve Gam Ken Ba Aretz, Ba Tel Aviv. My name is Daniel Wildmann. I'm the head of program of the Michael Blumenthal Academy of the Jewish Museum Berlin, and I'm very honored to welcome all of you here or over there to tonight's event, A Peculiar Kinship, Eine Merkwürdige Verwandtschaft, Etgar Keret and Daniel Kehlmann. Etgar stated once in an interview that Germans and Israelis are not quite sure if they should cheer their own national football team. A quite relevant topic these days, well, at least for the Germans here in our room. According to Keret, this is yet one more indication that both Germany and Israel were born out of a trauma leading to, again, Keret's words, the peculiar kinship, die merkwürdige Verwandtschaft of Germans and Israelis. It's also this peculiar kinship which came into focus when Etgar asked his friend, the renowned author Daniel Kehlmann, to translate his collection of autobiographic essays, The Seven Good Years, a memoir, into German. Daniel Kehlmann is one of our most popular and most widely German book authors in our time, and he accepted the challenge, which he described as, I quote him, joyful, explaining then, another quote from Daniel Kehlmann, every engagement with a very good text influences one's own writing. Perhaps we will be lucky and hear more about this influence tonight. The German title of Keret's book, Die sieben guten Jahre, Mein Leben als Vater und Sohn, might lead us to believe that the book is all about fatherhood. However, a closer look at the book reveals that Keret is instead writing about his mother. And this discovery leads us directly to the exhibition Inside Out, which opened in the Jewish Museum Berlin about a month ago. Taking memories of his mother as his point of departure, Keret has written a number of new short stories exclusively for the exhibition. These stories, they portray both day-to-day life in Israel, where our author lives, and you will see him in a second, and traumatic wartime experiences inspired by the life of his mother, who was born in Poland in 1934. You see some of the stories here, and there are some more of these stories here. You're free to pick them up after our event. The German version of these new texts were recorded by no other than Daniel Kehlmann. These texts can be heard when scanning a QR code at the exhibition in our main building over there or on the website of our museum. But today we bring both friends together to talk about texts, about friendship, about kinship, and about, of course, translations. Well, actually, almost. Very unfortunately, Etgar, here he is, cannot join us physically. But I have no doubts he will project his winning presence via video to the Blumenthal Academy of the Jewish Museum in Berlin tonight. And because Etgar is joining us by screen, as you can see, we wanted to give Daniel Kehlmann some company on stage in Berlin. So here is Ofer Waldman. He will facilitate the conversation. Ofer is a musician, a scholar, and a journalist by trade. He curated the program accompanying the exhibition Inside Out, and we are delighted that he agreed to jump in tonight at a really very short notice. Thanks a lot. My thanks go out to the curators behind this exhibition, over there in our main building, Leonore Meyer and Daniel Ide. But my thanks go also out to the team behind this event here at the Academy, Signor Osbach, Gesa Struve, Falk Schneider, and Art Leitz. And I'm sure I also speak for the museum's director, Hetty Berg, and of course for us, the Academy of the Jewish Museum Berlin, when I say, let's enjoy the event. So Ofer, Etgar, Daniel, over to you. The floor is all yours.
Thank you very much, dear Daniel Wildmann, for your kind words. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I'm thrilled and honored that I may moderate this event tonight. Well, actually, I think my main task is not to disturb to the conversation of those two friends that we have invited tonight. And actually, since I know the vivid nature of their conversation, these words might be the last chance that I will get tonight to say any words. So I will just sit here and enjoy the conversation, but I promise we will have an opportunity for your questions in English or in German, whatever you prefer. But I will take the chance to introduce our two guests tonight. I will start with you, Daniel Kehlmann. The inspiration of Daniel Kehlmann, who is one of the most known German writing authors of our time, stretches literally across the world. From his admiration or inspiration from Vladimir Nabokov all the way to being described as a magical realist in the tradition of Latin American authors such as Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Now, this notion between Germany and the world resonates actually the two protagonists of maybe his most known work, Die Vermessung der Welt, which is, by the way, one of the most read and sold German novels of our time. So these two protagonists, the first, Alexander von Humboldt, tours the world, he goes to South America, he goes to the vast landscapes of Russia. The other protagonist, Gauss, the mathematician, stays in Germany where he studies and works. Now, Kehlmann's work has been awarded with a dazzling list of prizes, among which the Kleist Prize, and actually, as was recently published, he works now on a screenplay for a co-production of the ORF and the ARD about the life of work of yet another Jewish author who chooses to communicate with his father via books, that is Franz Kafka. And the communication with the father, or with the father via books, is maybe a good bridge to you, Edgar. I was told I have to look to the camera, so I will look there. It's a good bridge to you, Edgar, sitting in Tel Aviv, unfortunately, but as Daniel Wildmann said, I'm sure this will be, we will forget it in a second that you're not here physically with us. So Etgar Keret was referred to by Salman Rushdie as the voice of the next generation. Now, perhaps he meant my generation. I can definitely tell you, if you grew up in Israel of the late or of the 90s, Etgar Keret was the most significant and important gathering point, literary gathering point. Born 1967 in Ramat Gan in Israel, Keret is one of the most known Israeli authors of our time. As Kyle Smith puts it, he can do with six paragraphs what other authors can do with 600 pages. Now, but besides his very famous short stories, Keret wrote graphic novels and scripts for TV and for the cinema, and he was honored together with his wife Shira Geffen, among other prizes, with the Camera d'Or of the Cannes Film Festival. And actually, last Sunday, 2 days ago, we showed here The Middleman, Mein Sprechender Goldfisch, a miniseries he wrote and directed together with Shira Geffen for Arte. It was a beautiful production. And actually, if I can recommend you, you are more than welcome to join the Alphabet Soup, his blog on the internet, to join a truly mind-blowing journey through the work of Etgar Keret. And before I will send my first question to you, dear Edgar, Daniel Kehlmann will read us a story, actually from the book that you have translated from English to German, from the book The Good 7 Years, Die guten sieben Jahre. Bitte schön. Oder die sieben guten Jahre, Entschuldigung.
Die sieben guten.
Die sieben guten Jahre.
Guten Jahre. Yes, I'm gonna read a short. Well, they're all short, but a short one. Yeah, we'll talk about all that later. It's called Shit Happens. That's a German title. Shit Happens. Meine erste Geschichte habe ich vor 26 Jahren in einer der am besten bewachten Armeebasen Israels geschrieben. Ich war damals 19, ein schlechter, deprimierter Soldat, der nur die Tage bis zum Ende seiner Militärpflicht zählte. Ich schrieb die Geschichte während eines besonders langen Dienstes in einem isolierten, fensterlosen Computerraum tief unter der Erde. Ich stand in der Mitte dieses neonbeleuchteten, eiskalten Raumes und starrte auf das ausgedruckte Blatt. Ich konnte mir selbst nicht erklären, warum ich das geschrieben hatte oder welchem Zweck es dienen sollte. Der Umstand, dass ich all diese erfundenen Sätze getippt hatte, war aufregend, aber auch erschreckend. Mir war, als müsste ich sofort jemanden finden, der die Geschichte lesen würde. Und wenn sie dem nicht gefiele oder wenn er sie nicht verstünde, könnte er mich beruhigen und mir sagen, dass das Schreiben eine ganz normale Sache war und nicht ein weiterer Schritt auf dem Weg in den Wahnsinn. Der erste potenzielle Leser tauchte erst 14 Stunden später auf. Es war ein pockennarbiger Unteroffizier, der mich ablösen und den nächsten Dienst übernehmen sollte. Mit bemüht ruhiger Stimme sagte ich ihm, dass ich eine Kurzgeschichte geschrieben hatte, die er lesen müsse. Er nahm seine Sonnenbrille ab und sagte: "Leck mich am Arsch." Ich ging ein paar Stockwerke hinauf zum Erdgeschoss. Die vor kurzem erst aufgegangene Sonne blendete mich. Es war 6:30 Uhr morgens und ich brauchte unbedingt einen Leser. Wie immer, wenn ich ein Problem habe, machte ich mich auf den Weg zum Haus meines Bruders. Ich drückte den Knopf an der Gegensprechanlage und die schläfrige Stimme meines Bruders antwortete. "Ich habe eine Geschichte geschrieben", sagte ich. "Ich möchte, dass du sie liest. Kann ich raufkommen?" Nach einem Moment der Stille sagte mein Bruder bedauernd: "Keine gute Idee. Du hast meine Freundin geweckt. Jetzt ist sie wütend." Nach einem weiteren Moment sagte er: "Wart auf mich. Ich ziehe mich an und komme mit dem Hund runter." Nach ein paar Minuten tauchte er mit seinem kleinen, ausgeblichen wirkenden Hund auf. Der Hund freute sich, so früh spazieren zu gehen. Mein Bruder nahm mir die bedruckte Seite aus der Hand und begann, sie im Gehen zu lesen. Aber der Hund wollte bleiben und an einer schmutzigen Stelle nahe dem Eingang des Gebäudes sein Geschäft verrichten. Er versuchte, sich mit seinen kleinen Pfoten in den Boden zu graben und Widerstand zu leisten. Aber mein Bruder war zu sehr ins Lesen versunken, um das zu bemerken. Er ging schnell die Straße entlang und zerrte den armen Hund mit sich. Zum Glück für den Hund war die Geschichte sehr kurz. Und als mein Bruder 2 Straßen weiter stehen blieb, konnte dieser sein Gleichgewicht zurückgewinnen und dem ursprünglichen Plan folgend sein Geschäft verrichten. "Diese Geschichte ist großartig", sagte mein Bruder. "Ich bin überwältigt. Hast du noch eine Kopie?" Ich sagte, dass ich eine hatte. Er gab mir ein großes "Bruder ist stolz auf kleinen Bruder" Lächeln, dann bückte er sich und benutzte die bedruckte Seite, um den Hundedreck in einen Mülleimer zu schaufeln. In diesem Moment begriff ich, dass ich Schriftsteller sein wollte. Ohne es zu wollen, hatte mein Bruder mir etwas beigebracht. Die Geschichte, die ich geschrieben hatte, war nicht das zerknitterte, mit Scheiße beschmierte Blatt, das jetzt auf dem Boden eines Mülleimers lag. Dieses Blatt war nur eine Rohrleitung, durch die ich meine Gefühle aus meinem Geist in seinen übertragen hatte. Ich weiß nicht, wie ein Magier sich fühlt, wenn er es das erste Mal fertig bringt, jemanden zu verzaubern. Aber es ist vielleicht mit dem vergleichbar, was ich in diesem Moment empfand. Ich hatte eine Form der Magie entdeckt, die mir helfen würde. Die 2 langen Jahre bis zu meiner Entlassung aus dem Militärdienst zu überstehen.
So it sounds beautiful in German. I hope that you can enjoy it as well, dear Etgar. And I will ask you later how it is to listen to your own poetry, to your own prose in German. But first, this book, the 7 Good Years, you wrote it in English and you specifically asked Daniel Kehlmann, the author Daniel Kehlmann, to translate it into German. How come?
First of all, it's nice to be here and all the other stuff. Hi, Daniel. And well, the book was supposed to be published in in a number of languages. I can't tell you exactly how many, but there were quite a few of them. And because the book was translated from English and not from Hebrew, then we had to find new translators, you know, because translators from Hebrew are not necessarily the best translators from English. And it was something that each publisher in each country chose by themselves. But I had this thing in my mind that I wanted Daniel to translate the book to German. I think that we didn't even know each other that well, you know. I mean, we know each other through the writing, but we kind of met a couple of times or something like that. But there was something about my universe that it's actually a very simple and minimalistic universe. You know, it's me, it's my wife, it's our only son. The way that we kind of move around like this, I don't know, little Western posse, you know, kind of changing the roles in our little triangle, and also this kind of I can't find the right word, but this kind of a connection to our fathers, you know, but something that is I would say much even more fundamental than loving or respectful, but something about this idea that there was a parent there who kind of showed the way or was some kind of, I cannot say, ethical or aesthetic, philosophical kind of a needle or something that you can kind of orientate yourself by. Now, I'm saying all those things that I'm saying, they're true for me, but somehow I imagine that they were true for Daniel too. And there is something about nonfiction that it's strange, but for me, it's much more intimate than fiction. It's like, I think that the most important thing in my body of writing is fiction. I like writing fiction, but when you write something that is nonfiction, then it kind of feels even stranger that somebody who really doesn't know you will write about the death of your father or you being with him in the last minute. So it kind of, the idea is that a translation that was important for me to German, I said, well, at least in one language, I have the guys that, you know, that I trust and everything. The only problem is that he doesn't translate from English. But Daniel is so nice and so generous that after 5 minutes, he agreed.
So, Daniel Kehlmann, I mentioned that you work about Kafka, and Kafka wrote this amazing text, Brief an den Vater, letter to his father. And as Etgar is saying, maybe like Kafka, this experience of writing with or writing towards the father, the experience, as Etgar mentioned, of fatherhood, of being a father, because the book, The 7 Good Years, these 7 good years are basically between the birth of Etgar's son and the death of his father. And he said this is an experience that you both share. How did you experience this shared experience while you translated the book?
Yeah, I felt very... I mean, in my life, I didn't have those overlap of the life of my son and the life of my father, sadly. My father died before my son was born, but that made me kind of, I mean, I understand the feelings very well. And I felt very sad that I didn't have these good years that Etgar describes. But I mean, I had other good years in other ways, but I didn't have this perfect overlap of, in his case, 7 years between his son and his father. And I have to tell you why I decided to do this. I would say there are three or four reasons. So one is, of course, that I love Etgar's writing, and I felt, as you say, I felt also very close to such a personal book of his. Another reason that was kind of might have been subconscious is that now I can always drop like, oh, I translated an Etgar Keret book. And people think I speak Hebrew. Then, of course, if they ask, I will say, no, it wasn't from Hebrew. But if they don't ask, I take it. I just move on and leave them very impressed. Then also, I have to... yesterday I looked it up and I printed out an email Etgar wrote to me when he asked me, and I'll just read you one paragraph. And he wrote, "The seven good years for me is for me the most emotionally close to my heart book because it deals both with the death of my beloved father and the birth of my crazy little son. And its translation to German is especially important since it is the only language, besides Hebrew, my mother feels comfortable reading in. And since the book will not come out in Hebrew and is the only book I've ever written and will probably ever write in English. I can only imagine how busy you are and how swamped you probably are with mails like the one I am sending, but can only try to effect your decision with a promise that if you'll say yes, I will owe you big time and will be happy to do anything to repay you, from foot massage through sharing my secret hummus recipe to taking care of critics who had done you wrong. I have a friend or two in the Mossad. Nathan," that's our friend Nathan Englander, whom we share. "Nathan, who was kind enough to translate me in the past, could vouch for my foot massage skills. You will have to trust me for the rest." I mean, how can you say no to that?
I will take a note that you have a great hummus recipe, and I will send you the mail asking for it later. But it's actually strange. You know, I thought about it that this autobiographic book about your father was published in many other languages, I think in Farsi as well, in Iran, but not in Hebrew, not in Israel. And the exhibition about your mother, that was mentioned by Daniel Wildman, the exhibition that is running now here at the Jewish Museum, is as well outside of the realm of the Hebrew language. So in a way, the two most autobiographic projects that you have done are outside of Israel and outside basically of the realm of the Hebrew language. How come?
It wasn't premeditated, but I think that there is something about writing that it allows me some kind of a sincerity that I don't always have in life. You know, when I write because it's fiction and I make up a character and I make up a situation, I can bring all kinds of darker, wilder, crazier side of myself. And whatever people read in the text, you know, I can always say, hey, it's a fiction, I made it up. And when you write nonfiction, it's a problem because it's not only you, it's all the people around you are involved. And I must say that, you know, that I'm not very good at knowing what stuff you're supposed to say and what you're not supposed to say and how you should conduct things. I can say that, you know, that, for example, I once wrote a piece for the New York Times, and in the piece I mentioned that my wife and I, my wife had a miscarriage that week. And for me, it was kind of like talking to somebody, you know. I never kind of know the difference of kind of resonance, but of course, when you do it in the New York Times, all kinds of aunts begin calling my wife saying, hey, we read in the paper that you had a miscarriage. So I'm not very good at kind of doing this stuff. And I think that there is something that when you go away, far away from where you live, that it makes it for me the way I think about it makes it much more cleaner. It's kind of, it's not like thinking about what will this neighbor think about this story, or what will the guy from the store think when it comes to the exhibition. You know, it kind of makes it a statement. And one thing I can say about the exhibition, that it was important for me that the people who will go through the exhibition will know as little as they can pragmatic things about my mom. You know, that they don't even know, if you go through the exhibition, you know tons of things about her, but you don't know how she looks like. I think that you don't even know her name. So this is kind of a thing that it's easier to pull when you're far away. There was something about, you know, I mean, the story of the exhibition is random and chaotic and wonderful, like most things in my life. But for me, Berlin, for example, was the city to which I went to with my mother for her 70th birthday. it was very, very moving weeks that we had here together, and a kind of closure, I think, because I can talk about that, but maybe it's less important. But the German language was the language that was the key or an important language for my parents. And when Daniel read the mail I wrote to him, I thought to myself, I'm such a macher, because my mother reads Polish and French too. But I must say that she loved Daniel's translation. And of course, you know, because it's a book that a lot of it is about my father and about my grandchild, it was kind of a book that she would revisit, and she would revisit it in German and not in English, in German and in Polish.
So maybe, Daniel Kehlmann, you want to read ganz unten from the book, another part.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite stories in the book. It's about Edgar's father. It's called ganz unten. Ich habe einen guten Vater. Da habe ich Glück, ich weiß. Nicht jeder hat einen guten Vater. Letzte Woche bin ich mit ihm zu einem Routinetest ins Krankenhaus gegangen und die Ärzte haben uns gesagt, dass er sterben wird. Er hat fortgeschrittenen Krebs an der Wurzel seiner Zunge, jene Art von Krebs, von der man nicht mehr gesund wird. Der Krebs hat meinen Vater schon vor einigen Jahren überfallen, die Ärzte waren damals optimistisch und er hat es wirklich geschafft. Diesmal, sagten die Ärzte, gäbe es folgende Optionen. Wir könnten entweder gar nichts tun und mein Vater würde in einigen Wochen sterben. Oder er könnte sich einer Chemotherapie unterziehen und falls das funktioniere, würde es ihm noch ein paar zusätzliche Wochen bescheren. Oder sie könnten ihm Strahlungstherapie geben, aber das würde aller Wahrscheinlichkeit nach mehr schmerzen als helfen. Oder sie könnten operieren und seine Zunge und seinen Kehlkopf herausnehmen. Es wäre eine komplizierte Operation, die länger als 10 Stunden dauern würde. Und in Anbetracht des fortgeschrittenen Alters meines Vaters hielten die Ärzte das nicht für eine realistische Möglichkeit. Meinem Vater aber gefiel die Idee. In meinem Alter brauche ich keine Zunge mehr. Nur Augen im Kopf und ein Herz, das schlägt, erklärte er der jungen Onkologin. Das Schlimmste, was passieren kann, ist, dass ich Ihnen nicht sagen kann, wie schön Sie sind. Dann schreibe ich es auf. Die Ärztin wurde rot. Es geht nicht nur um die Sprache, es ist das Trauma der Operation. Es ist das Leiden und die Rehabilitation, falls Sie überleben. Wir sprechen hier von einer gewaltigen Einbuße an Lebensqualität. Ich liebe das Leben. Mein Vater schenkte ihr sein eigensinniges Lächeln. Wenn die Qualität gut ist, umso besser. Wenn nicht, dann eben nicht. Ich bin nicht wählerisch. Auf dem Heimweg im Taxi hielt mein Vater meine Hand, als ob ich wieder 5 Jahre alt wäre und wir eine sehr befahrene Straße überqueren wollten. Er sprach aufgeregt von den verschiedenen Behandlungsmöglichkeiten, so wie ein Unternehmer über neue Geschäftsideen spricht. Mein Vater ist Geschäftsmann, kein Tycoon im dreiteiligen Anzug, nur ein gewöhnlicher Mann, der gern kauft und verkauft und wenn er nicht kaufen oder verkaufen kann, ist er bereit zu vermieten oder zu mieten. Für ihn ist das Geschäft ein Weg, Leute zu treffen, sich zu unterhalten, ein wenig Bewegung in die Sache zu bringen. Man muss ihn nur eine Schachtel Zigaretten am Kiosk kaufen lassen und innerhalb von 10 Minuten spricht er mit dem Mann hinter der Theke über eine mögliche Partnerschaft. Wir sind hier wirklich in einer idealen Situation, sagte er völlig ernsthaft, während er meine Hand streichelte. Ich treffe gerne Entscheidungen, wenn die Dinge auf dem Tiefpunkt sind. Und die Situation ist so ein Dreck, dass ich nur als Gewinner daraus hervorgehen kann. Mit Chemo sterbe ich praktisch sofort. Mit der Bestrahlung bekomme ich Wundbrand im Kiefer. Und jeder ist sicher, dass ich die Operation nicht überleben werde, weil ich 83 bin. Kannst du dir vorstellen, wie viele Grundstücke ich genauso gekauft habe? Wenn der Eigentümer nicht verkaufen wollte und ich keinen Groschen in der Tasche hatte? Ja, ich weiß, sagte ich. Und ich weiß es wirklich. Als ich 7 war, zogen wir um. Unser altes Apartment war in derselben Straße wie das neue. Und wir alle liebten es. Aber mein Vater bestand darauf, dass wir eine größere Wohnung bräuchten. Während des Zweiten Weltkriegs versteckten sich mein Vater, seine Eltern und noch ein paar Menschen fast 600 Tage lang in einem Loch im Boden in einer polnischen Stadt. Das Loch war so klein, dass sie darin weder stehen noch sich hinlegen konnten, sondern nur sitzen. Als die Russen die Region befreiten, mussten sie meinen Vater und meine Großeltern heraustragen, weil sie sich allein nicht bewegen konnten. Ihre Muskeln waren atrophiert. Die Zeit, die er in dem Loch verbracht hatte, hatte ihn in Fragen der Privatsphäre recht empfindlich gemacht. Der Umstand, dass mein Bruder, meine Schwester und ich in dem gleichen Raum aufwuchsen, machte ihn regelrecht verrückt. Er wollte, dass wir in eine Wohnung zögen, in der wir alle unsere eigenen Zimmer haben könnten. Uns Kindern gefiel es, ein Schlafzimmer zu teilen. Aber wenn mein Vater einmal etwas entschieden hat, kann man nichts mehr dagegen machen. Eines Samstags, ein paar Wochen, bevor wir unser altes Apartment, das er schon verkauft hatte, hätten verlassen sollen, ging mein Vater mit uns die neue Wohnung ansehen. Wir alle duschten und zogen uns unsere schönsten Kleider an, obwohl wir wussten, dass wir dort niemanden treffen würden. Aber man geht ja nicht jeden Tag seine neue Wohnung besichtigen. Obgleich das Gebäude fertiggestellt war, wohnte noch niemand darin. Nachdem er sichergestellt hatte, dass wir alle im Lift waren, drückte mein Vater auf den Knopf für den 5. Stock. Es war eines der wenigen Häuser in der Gegend, die einen Lift hatten. Und sogar die kurze Fahrt war aufregend. Mein Vater öffnete die Wohnungstür aus verstärktem Stahl und begann uns die Zimmer zu zeigen. Zuerst die Kinderzimmer, dann das Elternschlafzimmer und schließlich das Wohnzimmer und den riesigen Balkon. Die Aussicht war großartig und wir alle, besonders mein Vater, waren entzückt über den magischen Ort, der unser neues Heim sein würde. »Habt ihr je so eine Aussicht gesehen?«, fragte er, umarmte meine Mutter und zeigte auf den grünen Hügel, den man durchs Wohnzimmerfenster sah. »Nein«, antwortete meine Mutter ohne Enthusiasmus. »Warum schaust du so mürrisch?« »Weil hier kein Fußboden ist«, flüsterte meine Mutter und sah hinunter auf den Schmutz und die freiliegenden Metallröhren unter unseren Füßen. Erst in diesem Moment blickten ich, mein Bruder und meine Schwester hinab und sahen, was meine Mutter sah. Ich meine, wir hatten schon vorher alle gesehen, dass da kein Fußboden war. Aber irgendwie, wegen der Begeisterung und des Enthusiasmus meines Vaters, hatten wir diesem Umstand keine große Beachtung geschenkt. Mein Vater blickte jetzt ebenfalls hinab. Entschuldigung, sagte er, es war kein Geld mehr übrig. Nach dem Umzug muss ich den Boden putzen, sagte meine Mutter mit ihrer alltäglichen Stimme. Ich kann Kacheln putzen, aber nicht Sand. Du hast recht, sagte mein Vater und versuchte sie zu umarmen. Der Umstand, dass ich recht habe, wird mir nicht helfen, das Haus sauber zu kriegen. Okay, sagte mein Vater, wenn du jetzt aufhörst, darüber zu sprechen und mir eine Minute lässt, wird mir was einfallen, das weißt du, nicht wahr? Meine Mutter nickte, aber es sah nicht sehr überzeugend aus. Die Liftfahrt hinab war weniger froh. Als wir einige Wochen später in das neue Apartment einzogen, waren die Böden zur Gänze mit Keramikkacheln belegt, in jedem Raum eine andere Farbe. Im sozialistischen Israel der frühen 70er Jahre gab es nur eine Art von sesamfarbener Kachel. Und diese bunten Böden in unserer Wohnung, rot, schwarz und braun, waren anders als alles, was wir je gesehen hatten. Siehst du? Mein Vater küsste meine Mutter stolz auf die Stirn. Ich hab dir gesagt, mir fällt was ein. Erst einen Monat später fanden wir heraus, was genau ihm eingefallen war. Ich war gerade allein zu Hause und nahm eine Dusche. Als ein grauhaariger Mann in einem weißen Button-Down-Hemd mit einem jungen Paar in unser Badezimmer kam. Das sind unsere vulkanroten Kacheln, direkt aus Italien, sagte er und zeigte auf den Boden. Die Frau entdeckte mich als Erste, wie ich sie nackt und eingeseift anstarrte. Die drei entschuldigten sich schnell und verließen das Badezimmer. An diesem Abend, als ich allen erzählte, was geschehen war, verriet mein Vater uns sein Geheimnis. Da er nicht das Geld gehabt hatte, um für Bodenkacheln zu bezahlen, hatte er einen Handel mit der Keramikfirma abgeschlossen. Sie würden uns die Kacheln umsonst geben und mein Vater würde ihnen gestatten, unsere Wohnung als Modellapartment zu benutzen. Das Taxi hatte schon die Wohnung meiner Eltern erreicht. Als wir ausstiegen, hielt mein Vater immer noch meine Hand. Genau so treffe ich gern Entscheidungen. Wenn es nichts zu verlieren und alles zu gewinnen gibt, wiederholte er. Als wir die Wohnungstür öffneten, begrüßte uns ein angenehmer, wohlvertrauter Geruch, hunderte farbiger Bodenkacheln und eine einzige kraftvolle Hoffnung. Wer weiß, vielleicht werden uns auch diesmal das Leben und mein Vater mit einem unerwarteten Handel überraschen.
This book was an important milestone on the way of Etgar Keret to become present in the German room in Germany, in the German language. Another milestones were when the Jewish Museum Berlin showed his Corona piece outside, here on the outside wall of the museum during Corona, and then of course the exhibition outside, Inside Out. So there is this dance of Etgar Keret with the Jewish Museum, which is in the same time a dance of Etgar Keret with Berlin, with Germany. How do you experience this dance of Etgar with Germanness?
That's very interesting, because he also, maybe he could talk more about that, but he came to Berlin for quite a while last year and spent a few months here. And I think if the weather had been a little bit better, he might still be living here. But I mean, Berlin, there are so many great things about Berlin, and we all know them and we all share them and we love the city, but there's no denying the winter can be very, very dark. And I think the winter was a little bit too dark for Etgar. I mean, who can blame him? But I think my experience was that he had a lot of fun in Berlin anyway, even though it was Berlin in lockdown, and he seems to really like Berlin. But I mean, maybe I'm wrong. Tell us.
No. I really do like Berlin, and I think that, you know, when I had a sabbatical, then it was one of the first two places that came to my mind, and I spent a few months in Berlin already 20 years ago. I was a Samuel Fischer guest professor in the FO. And I kind of, it's a place that I keep returning to. And as I said, it was the place I took my mom to. And for me, there is something about Berlin specifically. I think German in general, but Berlin specifically, is that it's maybe the city that reminds me the most of Tel Aviv, the place that I live in. Because I feel that when I go to places like, let's say, France, it looks like a museum of the 19th century. When I go to New York, it looks like the museum of the 20th century. You know, the policemen are overweight and eat donuts and speak in the right accent, and everything is according to plan. But Berlin and Tel Aviv, they are those kind of places that can totally surprise you, that there is almost kind of like a debate about what Berlin is like and what Tel Aviv is like. And I think that this usually comes, this idea is this kind of a ambiguity or many options about an identity. I think that they usually come together with some kind of a trauma in the past. And I must say that in the many visits that I had in Germany, it was much easier for me, for example, to talk about my experiences and fears in my relationship with my parents than it would have been in the US or in France or in any other places, because I also felt that in Germany, two people are wrestling with their past. I must say that, you know, I started visiting Berlin when I was about 14 or 15 years old. My parents had those compensations for Holocaust survivors, and they would go to Bad Reichenhall to have treatments. So basically, I would kind of fly to Germany on summer, and it was always this kind of place that had some kind of a strong affinity. I there was some kind of a trauma, and the trauma, there may have been, I don't know, victims and victimizers, but everybody kind of shared this thing, this kind of feeling of this big thing, unresolved thing from your past. So for some reason, I find myself returning to Germany, and very quickly, I kind of understood that Berlin is much more my kind of city than Düsseldorf, you know, or Bremen, or even Munich. And it became like a good place to try and live in for a year. But as Daniel said, after 6 months, we returned home. It was very dark and we missed our rabbit. But I know that this sounds like very lame excuses.
Well, we're very happy every time to find another excuse to get you back in Berlin, in body or via the screen. And indeed, when I was asked short notice to join you, Daniel Kehlmann, on the stage, we talked about what themes can we talk about tonight. And it was not only the past, the shared trauma that you have mentioned, this merkwürdige Verwandtschaft, the peculiar kinship, but it was also the present challenges. And I took the liberty of translating a phrase that you, Daniel Kehlmann, have said in an interview, again about Franz Kafka. And you said, Franz Kafka's nightmares are our daily reality. In his sinister yet funny visions, he pre-guessed the world in which we all live now. These visions did not come from thin air, but were formed out of his life, his family, and his private surroundings. Do you share these visions, Etgar, this sinister but funny reality that Kafka previsioned for our reality? Do you believe in the force of literature to pre-guess reality?
Yeah, I must say that, you know, that I think that in Kafka's case, like Daniel said many times, he acted like a prophet. But more than that, I think that sometimes when you read a great writer, then he's basically able to perceive something that was always there, but in some kind of a blind spot. Mm-hmm. You know, I think in a sense, it's like when we go through some kind of an experience today and we say, oh, it was so Kafkaesque, you know, there's such a bureaucrat, then people went through these experiences before Kafka was born, but they just didn't have a name for it, or maybe didn't even have the ability to differentiate this from the other experiences, you know. So I feel close to that, and I must say that, you know, that I really like. I think the period we're going through is so crazy and extreme and keeps changing. You know that. You know, it's as my son says. At least it's not boring. You know, but. But I don't necessarily feel it's pleasant. And I think, you know, if I had to look for a metaphor for how I see the reality today, I think it's like as if the world is this kind of a dysfunctional ER room, you know, in a hospital. It's in the middle of the night. There are like hundreds of patients. All of them are very angry because they didn't really get well treated. And then this kind of a tired doctor steps in, you know, with about to call the next person, and everybody's just running at him and shouting at the doctor and cursing and saying, this is ridiculous. You know, my wife is waiting here for 3 hours. And all those people, they think that all the other people's pain is not as great as theirs. And they think that the system done them wrong. And they feel that they're very active because they're arguing and they're putting a Facebook post on it. But in the bottom line, you know, this ER is not a pleasant place. You know, if I would feel unwell, I would rather go somewhere else. And I really feel this kind of this idea that I just read today that Merriam-Webster's word of the year, the dictionary picks a word every year, is gaslighting. And I thought that it's so appropriate that it will be gaslighting, because, you know, gaslighting is a word, not only that it doesn't talk about something that is being changed in the world, it's about, you know, kind of claiming about something that is in the world that it doesn't really exist in the world. Really, like, let's say it's not like building a pyramid or making a missile. It just basically bullshitting with people, but it's a word that in its core, it has malice. Gaslighting basically could be something that may be a misunderstanding or a lie out of fear or something. But when you say gaslighting, it really sounds kind of malicious, you know, to gaslight somebody, to make them crazy and stuff. And I think that this kind of idea of picking a kind of a narrative, making a kind of a splitting the world to good guys and bad guys and things that we, people that we like and people that we hate, it's something that we see all over the place. And I must say that I come from Israel and I'm a liberal left winger. So I'm, it's not that I'm afraid with clashing with people about their ideas. It's like all, but all my life, the people I clashed with were right wingers. Many of them were racists. Many of them were messianic. So I said, okay, you know, these are the people that I'm about to fight with. But now when I go to the street, I don't know what am I going to do wrong next. You know, people can attack me for being vaccinated or not vaccinated, or being a misogyn, or being a chauvinist, or doing this or not doing this or thinking that. But the things that all of those fights have in common is that when people disagree with you today, they think you're the Antichrist, you know? They will kind of bash your brain for the silliest thing. I used to be in a situation where, you know, I don't know, if somebody would run after you in the street in Europe, you know, he will be probably an anti-Semite, you know? But today it could just be somebody who's vegan and who's angry at me for just being a vegetarian. You know, you really don't know. It's not even like half the world fighting half the world. It's basically a little groups of partisans fighting each other to the death on something that you just think that maybe 6 months from now, people won't even remember what it was.
I ask myself, because Etgar just said that, you know, there were Kafkaesque situations since the beginning of humanity, but we need Franz Kafka in order to describe them. And you said about translating Etgar Keret to German that you become actually a better author when you translate such a good author as Etgar Keret. Mm-hmm. So are there situations that we're going to say these are Keretche situations? We need the language, we need the prose of Etgar Keret to describe them?
I mean, he's in some ways similar to Kafka. If they both have a wonderful sense of... or let's say a complete absence of pretension. Like the thing that defines Kafka, other than of course also that he saw the phenomenon of bureaucracy when no one else saw it quite as the phenomenon it was, it's also that with Kafka, Kafka never sees himself or the you can't even say hero, the protagonist of the his writing. He never sees either himself or the protagonist in any way as strong, big, powerful, a winner. That's unthinkable. It's always writing from the perspective of the small, the losing side, the weak side, and that makes it so honest. And I wouldn't say Etgar shares that, but he does share part of that. Etgar's stories are never written from the perspective of a strong and big guy. There's the deep, also quite physical truth of that. In most situations in life, we feel small and we feel like losers. And when we feel small and when we feel like losers, that's when we have the most profound observations and our best understanding of what the world is really like. There's a deep honesty in that, and I think in very different ways. I'm not saying they're similar writers, but in some ways they share this sentimentality. Maybe there's some common ground in Jewish writing. I mean, that's for others to interpret. There are also completely different Jewish writers, there's some real deep honesty in their humor and humor in their honesty. And the big difference is, of course, when you read or translate Etgar Keret, you feel like you want to write yourself because it's fun. You feel like there's an energy there, a joy. With Kafka, the reading a lot of Kafka for that work I'm done with now, the writing the six-part TV show about his life, Kafka is so rigorous in his understanding of literature and his claim to himself that any kind of literature that doesn't get that doesn't grow out of a deep trance-like profound connection with your own subconscious is kind of dishonest, and the world doesn't need that. And that's actually why he didn't finish most of what he wrote, because his standards were so rigorous that he couldn't fulfill them. And when you really immerse yourself in Kafka, writing becomes very hard, because you just take on his principles. You can't help it, and you feel like, oh my God, I'm just, this is not honest and truthful enough. And it's very good to go through that, but if you really stay there, then you just stop writing, like he did. And on most things he was working on.
So maybe the perspective of writing from the standing point of a vegetarian running away from a vegan on the streets of Berlin makes it a little bit, at least comic, even funny.
But by the way, Kafka.
Finally,
I find
you
Kafka,
disturbed me. I was waiting for this moment. Go for it.
I find Kafka in many of his writing super funny.
Yes, yes. I didn't mean to say he's not. Like, he is very, yeah, very funny. But he was also very, very brutal and harsh on himself. Like,
yeah. But I want to say that, you know, I started reading Kafka during my compulsory basic training in Israel. And at that time, I really thought that I was maybe the world's worst misfit, because I was very kind of stressful and erotic. And also I had this kind of thing, you know, talking about Kafka, this kind of idea of sincerity, is that I should tell people what I think about them. But a word of advice, never tell your sergeant major what you really think about him. It's really, it's not you may feel good with yourself, but you're gonna pay for that. And basically it was during my basic training that they detained me for doing something wrong. And I basically looked for books and I couldn't find any books, and I found Metamorphosis and other stories. And I started reading them. And I think that you know, that when Daniel talked about this idea that there's no point in writing if you don't write something that is sincere, or if you don't connect to your subconscious, then I wouldn't say that I'm that severe with myself, but I think that for me, writing works only if it surprises you, only if you feel that you are not controlling the story. I mean, at least not completely. It's when I always tell my students that that for me, story is not like a tool, you know, like, I don't know, a hammer or a knife, but a story is like a horse. When you ride a horse, you know where you're going to, but you're always attentive to the horse. If it's weak, you stop. If it's thirsty, you give it water. If it refuses to go somewhere, then you take another path. And I think that my feeling with the story, I say that by definition, for me, a good story has to be more intelligent than the person who writes it. Because if the story is as intelligent as you are, then you're not writing a story, or you're not making art, but you're assembling an IKEA furniture. Mm-hmm. You're doing something that you know exactly what you're doing. And I think that there is something about the act of creation, like, I don't know, like making love, or maybe I'll find a better metaphor, but that it can't work, for me at least, if you're totally in control all the time. You know, if you really know that I'm gonna do this, and this is gonna do that, and this is gonna happen to the audience when they read it, and it will be a happy end, then there is something about it that feels very, very mechanical. But I think that when you get entangled in the story, when the story kind of starts pulling you to places that you don't want to go, then it really becomes interesting.
Yeah, and I mean, especially there's some very strong electric charge or current in Etgar's stories. I think the one thing that all his stories share is they're really high energy in a way. I mean, try reading or listening. They're also very good for being listened to. Try listening to an Etgar Keret story and try stop before you're done. It's impossible. And that also helps you in translating them. It's always high energy. There's some electricity that carries you through it. And the other thing that I found very interesting, and of course I cannot read Etgar sadly in Hebrew. I think that would open another dimension for me. But even in English, or when I read him in somebody else's German translation, he has such a wonderful, strong simplicity. Like simplicity in the way that there is no pretension. And that simplicity is quite hard to translate sometimes, because it's not like you have a sentence to translate and the simplest way to do it comes to you first. It usually doesn't. Usually, your first idea is a version that's a little bit too complicated. And you feel like, yeah, but that doesn't do him justice, because it's a little bit too complicated, a little bit too IKEA-like, and like assembling an IKEA. I love that. And therefore, it kind of interrupts the flow of energy. And so the simplicity is what makes it hard to translate, which is a strange experience, and also a great one, because again, for your own writing, finding simplicity is always good. It's always helpful.
So perhaps before we give you, the audience, the chance to pose questions, I will ask you, Daniel Kehlmann, to read another story that was not translated by you, but by Barbara Linne, who translated the stories you can find here on the floor and in the exhibition itself. The story is Ein guter Tag, a good day.
Please. Ein guter Tag. Als Kind ging ich am allerliebsten in Restaurants. Und dabei war ich kein Feinschmecker, aber damals in den 70er Jahren im sozialistischen Israel war es ein so seltenes und dekadentes Ereignis, in ein Restaurant zu gehen, dass man gar nicht anders konnte, als aufgeregt zu sein. Alle paar Monate einmal fuhren wir zu Viktors Treffpunkt, ein populäres Tel Aviver Steakhouse, das an einen Schrottplatz angrenzte. Nach dem Essen, wenn meine Mutter und mein Vater schwarzen Kaffee tranken und eine Zigarette rauchten, drehte mein Bruder mit meiner Schwester und mir eine aufregende Runde auf dem Schrottplatz, den wir Autofriedhof nannten. Jedes Mal blieben wir bei einem anderen zerquetschten Fahrzeug stehen und spekulierten darüber, wie es da wohl hingelangt war. Es war von einem Elefanten zertrampelt, aus dem Rachen einer Kanone geschossen worden oder einfach zu schnell gefahren und mit einer Ampel zusammengestoßen. An einem Schabbat, als ich ungefähr 6 war, fuhren wir zu Viktors Treffpunkt, um den gemeinsamen Geburtstag meiner Mutter und meiner Schwester zu feiern. Der schnurrbärtige Kellner, der den Tisch mit einem nassen Lappen abwischte, teilte uns in entschuldigendem Ton mit, dass wegen einer Fehlleistung des Kochs das Restaurant heute keine Pommes frites servieren könne. Der Rest der Familie nahm die Nachricht mit einer gewissen Gleichgültigkeit auf, doch mich traf sie sehr hart. Statt köstlich fettiger Pommes stellte der Kellner eine Platte Reis auf den Tisch. Und innerhalb einer Sekunde wurde das ausschweifende, dekadente Festmahl, auf das ich seit Wochen gewartet hatte, zu einem weiteren ganz normalen Familienessen. Meine Mutter, die meine Frustration spürte, fragte mich, ob alles in Ordnung sei. Ich erwiderte zornig, überhaupt nichts sei in Ordnung, denn ohne Pommes sei das ganze Essen nichts wert und dieser Geburtstag, der ein Spaß und ein Vergnügen sein sollte, sei ab sofort der traurigste Tag in meinem Leben geworden. Meine Mutter hörte sich meine ganzen bitteren Klagen geduldig an und als ich fertig war, legte sie anstelle einer Antwort ihren warmen Handrücken an meinen Hals und bat mich, halb flüsternd für sie zu zählen, wie viele Gäste sich momentan im Restaurant befanden. Als ein braver Junge zählte ich alle gewissenhaft. Shabbat Mittag war eine der populärsten Zeiten der Woche in Viktors Treffpunkt. Und abgesehen von unserem Tisch gab es noch 26 Essensgäste im Lokal. 26. Meine Mutter stieß einen anerkennenden Pfiff aus. Das ist eine Menge. Könntest du mir bitte sagen, was diese ganzen Leute in der Hand halten? Also wirklich, sagte ich und grinste sie an. Das ist doch ganz einfach. Das ist ein Restaurant. Sie halten Messer und Gabeln in der Hand. 26 Leute, meinte meine Mutter beeindruckt. 26 hungrige Menschen sitzen an ihren Tischen. Und jeder isst nur von seinem eigenen Teller. 26 Menschen halten Messer in ihren Händen. Und trotzdem ersticht keiner den anderen. Sie beugte sich zu mir, küsste mich sanft auf die Stirn und sagte, komm, einigen wir uns drauf, dass heute ein guter Tag ist.
So, die Bühne gehört Ihnen. The floor is yours. Any questions for the audience? Don't be the first, be the second. Go for it. Then I will misuse my privilege as moderator and just keep on asking. But I encourage you to be courageous. Daniel Kehlmann, you just talked about how apparently simple the sentences of Etgar Keret are. And again, if you read Etgar Keret, I think, again, speaking for an entire generation, his stories look so simple that it made so many people say, oh, I can do it as well.
Yeah.
Started writing stories.
Good luck with that.
Good luck with that. Yeah. Sending them to the publisher. I guess most of the publishers in Israel hate you because they got tons of short stories from many young people who thought, ah, if Etgar Keret can do it, I can do it as well. But it's wrong because the simplicity is deceiving. And in our conversation before, you said it's a deceiving simplicity. How so?
I would say because there are so many ideas in there. And I mean ideas not in the abstract sense, but so many story ideas. It's so much, at first there's so much knowledge about the truths of life. So yeah, good luck with imitating that. You would need that knowledge. Because Etgar does seem like a little bit of a crazy person, but more than that, he's a wise man. He's a truly wise person, and he knows more about life than most people I know. And that is in the story. So on one hand, you have his true wisdom and understanding of human life, and on the other hand, you have this joy of storytelling. And he doesn't get in his own way, so his sentences really convey the story, but the story is not just some banal plot. It's some usually very strange chain of events that really convey his understanding of the world and his wisdom. And so the simplicity is important because the sentences don't get into the way of all that. And that's quite hard to do. Again, actually, the reason why he is able to achieve the simplicity is because there is so much energy and knowledge and such brilliant ideas in there. If you don't have any of that, then your sentences get more and more complicated. And there are other ways to write. I mean, there are writers, if you look at Nabokov, whom I admire so much, there's often not much happening, but there is so much incredible brilliance in just the metaphors, the sentences. The sentences are like a palace he builds. That's a completely different kind of writer. And that's also great, but that's not what Etgar does. Etgar is in a way, all about the sentences becoming transparent for what happens behind them. Maybe that's all wrong. Maybe you hate everything I just said, but...
Oh, come on, Daniel, when you say nice thing about me, that's always great. No, but what I want to say is really, for me, the essential thing about writing is, again, to be in some point of the process in a place where you really don't feel you control the story. You know, people talk about craft and mastery, but I'm thinking of this metaphor, but for me, I think it's like trying to write a story is like being in a confined cell and kind of banging against the door, you know, kicking it, punching it. And the moment that kind of the door opens, you fall down the stairs, you know, you roll with the story. And I think that this is a kind of process that when Daniel talked about how tough it was to try to kind of write in a Kafka way, then I can say that for me the feeling of writing a story is always kind of like, I don't know, beginning a startup, you know, pitching a startup. But the idea is that, you know, that the next day you're not going to develop the startup or fire a third of the workers in Twitter or something, but you're going to start from nothing and try to come up with another startup, kind of open, hoping that every time you were able to break free, to go through that door and fall down a different set of stairs, maybe you can kind of learn something about the, if not the word, the ways that you perceive the word.
But then there is also something that we novelists really envy in short story writers, because I completely understand what you say about craft, but for a novel, you kind of need to have these passages that you need some IKEA for a novel, so to speak. You need
for sure
some planning and craft. That's why there is no perfect novel. But there are quite a few absolutely perfect short stories. A short story and a poem, they can be perfect. I don't think a novel can be perfect in the same way. And again, that's why Kafka did not finish his novels, because he saw them wearing away from perfection, and he felt like now is the moment for craft, but he despised the idea of that. And of course, I mean, the novels are kind of perfect because they're unfinished, Kafka's novels. But if you're not him, you kind of have to finish your novels at some point.
I think that this idea, I really think that, you know, the Kafka place of writing is really this kind of a place of sincerity, mm-hmm. you know, of honesty. And the idea is that, you know, that if you build a structure and there's one wall missing and you can never sell this house to anybody, but you feel that you kept your integrity, like by this kind of, I don't know, strange Jesuit code or whatever, then it's like, I almost got it. And I really think that one thing that I feel many times when I have dialogues with novelists is that the novelists really, they look at a novel as a project, you know, as something that is kind of being built. And I feel the same when I work on movies or TV. But there is something about writing a story that it's almost like, I don't know, somebody who snatched your bag and ran in the street, that you sometimes can almost not recognize your own stories in that mm-hmm. sense. You know, it really doesn't have this kind of and the thing is that I, again, you know, I would love to one day be able to write a novel. But the thing is that whenever I try to write things that are longer, then I reach some kind of point where I say, to continue, I have to go back to the beginning and rewrite it from the beginning, and then I'll have the energy I need to keep on moving forward. And then, you know, about the 10 times that you were writing the first two chapters of a novel, you realize that maybe you better stick with short stories.
Yeah, but then also, why not? We have a friend, a mutual friend, Maxim, who keeps, of course, telling you you have to write a novel, and he keeps telling me I have to write different novels. maybe some of you can guess what Maxim we're talking about. But anyway, I think I wouldn't want you to write a novel. The same, I wouldn't want. I don't feel like it's so sad that Raymond Carver didn't write novels. I wouldn't. The short story is a perfect form, And I would say Carver or Keret, they're so good, they don't need to write novels.
Yeah, thank you for saying that, but what I think is that, you know, again, you know, when it comes to storytelling, I always feel that there are kind of new things that you can learn, and you know, and Daniel, you yourself, like, I mean, I think that there are some kind of writers that kind of mark a patch of ground and know every leaf in it. But you are very much in that sense, like me, kind of, you want to go on an adventure, you know, you want to go and enter something. And I feel that with me, I kind of, I wrote screenplays, I wrote theater plays, I directed, I wrote children book, I wrote the lyrics for songs. And all those kind of things were just another way of learning something about storytelling. Mm-hmm. And the one thing, this one adventure that I find almost impossible to have is actually writing a novel. And the thing is that for me, let's say, whenever I work on screenplays or on big project, it's very much like working on a novel, but you always have collaborators. Mm-hmm. You work with a director or a co-writer or an actor, and there is something about it that it's really like, you know, it's really like when, usually when I'm in restaurants, if the guy in front of me is nice, then before I leave, he says, ah, here, you have some tahini here and parsley here, and you have a stain here. And I say, oh, thank you for seeing me, you know? But when I write short stories and I'm totally on my own, I don't have this kind of teamwork aspect of being able to lean on somebody else and say, hey, Etgar, the story is actually about something else. How about you return to us and keep telling that story? And I must say that I do hope that one day I write a novel, but again, it will have to come from a place where I will believe that I keep getting the things that I'm getting from writing. And I must say that, you know, that for me, there is something about writing that it's a place of honesty. Because when you are, like, let's say, I believe as a child for Holocaust survivors, I was always very sensitive about the emotions of people around me, which really means that you're not 100% sincere. You're basically saying the things that will not offend, that will make other people happy. And then the discovery of art is that there is those kind of spaces that you can be totally yourself, and presumably there will be no collateral damages. You can shout into a hole in the ground, you can curse, you can admit things that you don't want to admit. And this is, for me, the primary function of writing. So I think that if I'm able to write a novel that will feel sincere, that it won't feel as if I'm trying to impress everybody, or, I don't know, to fake, and as if I'm somebody who's smarter than I really am, then maybe in the end I'll nail it. I don't know.
Any question from the audience? Ah, one. Please.
Just a question in general. I see these stories or novels, they are some kind of a cultural assurance or born from that. And I have a question in general, which is shaped by our time, I think, addressing cultural appropriation. Maybe that's not really going into the subject we were talking about, but it would be interesting to me what you are thinking about that. And yeah.
Was that a question? Would you prefer, who of our speakers you would prefer to answer?
To be honest, I heard that in some speech you were delivering most recently, mm-hmm. and to some personal reason, I was also, was dealing with that in a literary or whatever sense. Yes.
So,
to have to be confronted with that.
I mean, my speech that was in Marbach, I was talking about the problems of writing fiction about characters who really lived. And yes, and I didn't have any general theory on that. I was, you will soon be able to read the speech. It will be printed in Frankfurter Allgemeine. I was saying there's always an easy answer, and then there are more and more complicated answers as the longer you look into the question. And actually, one of my examples, I had several examples. One of my examples was actually the Kafka show I have written, and the question, is it necessary to have Jewish actors? And then I said, yeah, the first answer is always like, no, it doesn't matter at all. Acting is all about transformation, and it doesn't matter. And then I said, yes, that's very convincing. But then, would you also be convinced if an Elizabethan theater principal would have told you, you don't need women to play women on roles because acting is always transformation? It's more complicated than that. And then I also said, imagine a show about Kafka, which is shot in Germany, which is different, or by Germans, which is different than a show about Kafka done by French people or Americans. And if you imagine a show about Kafka and all the actor whose family was killed in the Holocaust, and all the actors are actually descendants from Nazis, just as a thought experiment. I mean, in terms of moral philosophy, there's nothing wrong with that, but still you wouldn't want that at all. You would feel really, you wouldn't want to watch that for complicated reasons. But I don't want to steal your time by repeating the whole speech, but I was also talking about the Winnetou scandal, the small Winnetou scandal we had in Germany when Ravensburg. I don't know whether you heard about that. When there was a Winnetou movie with German actors playing Indians, and then the books about that, the books, children's books based on that film, were taken out of circulation after people complained about it. And then you had all those, you had a lot of conservative journalists saying things like, this is censorship, this is the end of something. And I said, isn't it weird that we still have, that we still are shooting these movies with German people crawling through the woods playing Indians? Isn't that just, I'm not able to repeat the whole speech. I said, first, it's actually not the end of the world if these books then, if a publisher of school books then, which Ravensburger is, decides to take these books back and maybe not publish them. And then I also said the great danger of, of course, you can write about everything. That's the idea of literature. But if you write about something that is actually not connected at all to your life, then what usually happens is that you're making an idiot out of yourself. It just usually doesn't work. And and then also I said there is a reason why I, years ago, when no one used the term appropriation, why I didn't just write a magic realist novel in the style of Marquez or Cortázar, but while I felt the thing that made sense was to write my South American novel around a German explorer, because that has some connection to the world I know and to the to my own cultural background that I understand. And no one would have said appropriation back then. It just would have felt very strange to just write a novel that's set among South Americans with no connection to me. Sorry about the long answer, but that was pretty much what I was talking about in that speech.
So maybe my last chance to disagree with Daniel and have a heated argument. No, I'm just kidding. But what I wanted to say is that, for example, when you give the example of a Elizabethan theater, where they say women can be played by men or something like that, or even when you talk about German actors playing Indians, then this is basically the default, the system, and it doesn't allow women and minorities to act. But here we have something that is almost the reverse, because when somebody like Sarah Silverman says, I think that only Jews should, or that it prefers that Jews will play Jews, because this way they will not be misrepresented and stuff. What I think is that this claim ties the hand of filmmakers. It makes the world of imagination be a limited one. You know, if I would want to make a historical movie and cast Will Smith as Adolf Hitler, then I don't care if it's not appropriate. And I really feel that there is something very ridiculous. I must say, it's not nice to say ridiculous, and it's also dangerous this day. But I think that the idea is that when you say in the world of acting, I want to create some kind of limitation, because the moment that you make those, you impose that, then in the end you'll create some kind of an equivalent of a blackface. It doesn't matter to which direction, but it would mean that it's not a person sitting there and saying, yeah, that's how I wanted it, but it won't be Sarah Silverman, and in the New York Times they'll say I'm nice. When you're an artist and you think like that, the results become less truthful. And I said, in an event that I said, many people talk about that only minorities should be acted by minorities. That, let's say, if there's an invalid guy in a movie, it should be played by an invalid. And of course, that's true for transgenders or for other minorities. But I say to myself, I don't know, is it true if I would want to have an actor who's suffering from an incurable disease, why should I take a sick person to act, because otherwise it won't be truthful? I mean, when people talk about people being misrepresented, nobody in American movies was as misrepresented as sociopaths, from Hannibal Lecter on. So should I say that only people with mental issues, who disconnect emotionally from other people can act and play a sociopath killers? I think in the bottom line, when you write a sentence in your story or when you shoot a frame in your film, you basically sit there and you say, yes, that's how I want it. And you don't even say that's how the word is. You just say, you came here to hear my voice. This is my voice. And when it's my voice with another level of, yeah, but you should take this and represent this and do this, then it becomes a little bit kind of a distorted voice. And I want to say that in the end, our problem are in the word, not in the literature, not in history. When I see people in the US fight to ruin statues of slaveholder from 200 years ago, I say, this is our history. We should look at it. I wouldn't want people to wipe down from the earth all the mistakes that we've done, or ignore them, or ignore the fact that we respected people that today we think we're assholes. It's a process. And this kind of feeling of overprotection, it's really like, it feels like, people kind of do putting alcohol gel all the time before they shake your hand. Then sometimes I would like, to catch a flu, but have somebody who gives me a hug instead of somebody who showers in alcohol gel and projects positive energies for me from a distance, So what I'm saying, I'm not talking about the word, I'm just talking about an artist as an artist. And I think it's a weird, weird time to act as an artist, because if in the past I had, again, to deal with one front, people would say, I don't know, why do you have explicit sex? Why do you love Palestinians so much? Why do you think dogs are smarter than other people? I can deal with that. But the moment when people will say, in your story, you know, there are five people, but four of them are male and only one is a woman. Why did you make that choice, you know? And then I said, because it's a story about four guys who rape a woman and go to jail, and that's why I couldn't have three women and two men. You know, it's really like, the idea is I'm not good at this calculation. That's why I write. And when you read my story, they're not true. And if you see a TV show, it's not true. In my TV show, there is a fish that speaks, you know? They don't really do that. It's just me trying to tell you something between the words. And I wouldn't want to have people go walking around and say, you know, you want to say between the words, but please choose the words that we asked you to choose.
I would. I would actually like to say that we take 5 minutes recess and then we continue for another 1.5 hours, but I look at the watch and we're actually out of time. I saw that there was another question. Can we take another 5 minutes? I look at my chef. Yes. Okay, so another question, please.
I don't know if it's a basic question or if it's too personal, but since you, Etgar Keret, said that you didn't know Daniel Kehlmann that well when you asked him to translate your short stories, and now you seem quite close and like, as if you would be friends, I was wondering, since you're a short story writer or mostly known as that and you're a novelist, what did you learn from each other in a personal way and in a professional way?
Now I will say the sentence. I was sure I'm going to say it 10 times tonight, and I say it for the first time. Please keep it short, so we have only 5 minutes. Go ahead, Edgar.
Yeah. So I really want to say that there is an aspect of hubris for being a writer. In that sense that usually when I meet somebody for 5 minutes, I kind of make up the story. You know, I know what's their favorite dessert and which movies they like. And, you know, and when they, I don't know, I know, I make up everything. And again, many times when you meet people, you realize that it was a very nice story, but it's not exactly that person. And I must say that, you know, that with Daniel and with his family, I'd be very private and won't say details and stuff, but it's basically like I nailed it. I met Daniel, I said, wow, he's super smart and he's real nice and he knows a lot of stuff and he's a great friend. I want this guy by my side, and you know, and I nailed it. It's not as if I discovered that he was actually selfish and a closet Nazi, and I don't know, and he wears a strange clothes. That feeling, I think that the assurance that I recognized in Daniel something I have in myself, and I know that it's strange because we don't look the same, we don't write the same, and I think, you know, even we don't share the same mannerism. But I must say that when I see Daniel with his family, it's very, very much like as if when I'm with my family. And when I see Daniel speaking to Oscar, I think it's the only parent and son that I see this ever dialogue that reminds me of the dialogues that I have with Lev, our son. Short?
Yeah, I have a short answer. Other than all the things that he's a great writer and actually a wise person, and it's just a lot of fun to be with him. I'm not sure. I was told when I talked to Edgar, I have to talk to the camera, not to the screen. So I'm not sure I remember this. But that was actually one that changed my outlook on life. We were having lunch a few years ago, and somehow we were talking about the mysteries, the great big questions of physics. I think I started talking about that, and somehow I said that it would be unbearable to the worst part of not believing in an afterlife is that you will never learn about the truth behind the world. What's the truth behind quantum physics? Why is there nothing, something and not nothing? And if there's no afterlife, you just die and never learn the answers, and that really bothers me. And I remember you were looking at me and you said, that doesn't bother me at all. Life is not about finding out these things. Life is about loving. And that moved me so much, that life is actually about love. And I think that actually changed how I think about life. Wow. Yeah, that was a short answer.
Well, of course, after such a beautiful answer, after such beautiful two answers, thank you so much, Daniel Kehlmann. Thank you so much, Etgar Keret in Tel Aviv. Thank you, dear audience, of course. Thank you, Sina Rosbach. Thank you, Falk Schneider and the team from ArtLights and the staff of the Jewish Museum in Berlin. Thank you for coming.
Thank you
tonight.
All. Danke sehr.
Auf Wiedersehen. Thank you.
Auf Wiedersehen.